All right, welcome back to Close Up. Most people felt in 2014 he ran a pretty good campaign, so it's really not the best kept secret in the world. But now it is official. Dan Innes running once again for Congress in the 1st Congressional District. He's my next guest this morning. Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Congratulations on your decision.
Well,
was
thanks.
This an easy call for you?
I wouldn't say it was an easy call. I mean, this is a major decision, but it was a call that, you know when it's the right thing to do. And this is absolutely the right thing to do. I learned in the last run that people respond to my message. It's a strong message. We need to bring some change to Washington. We need to bring change to this seat. And I think that's ever more evident today than it was just a year ago.
Let me give you a take on, get your take on the past 8 months or so of your sitting back and watching everything that unfolded with the incumbent in the seat, Frank Ginta, his FEC troubles. Mm-hmm. I mean, were you just... did you second guess anything you did during the first campaign?
Of course you do. I mean, especially when you come up just short, you're going to second guess what you did. And you learn from it. You know, as a first-time candidate, there was a lot that I didn't know going in. There's a lot that I know now that I didn't know a year ago, and that will inform this race. I will run a different race this time, a different type of campaign. It'll be leaner, it'll be smarter, it'll be better, and we'll win.
Frank Ginta continues to insist that it was his money. I'm not going to go over the whole case all over again, but the FEC entered into a deal with him. It led to calls for his resignation from Senator Kelly Ayotte up to the leaders in Concord. Do you think that Congressman Ginta should have or perhaps should still resign?
Well, you know, that's a decision he has to make. Ultimately, it's the voters that make the decision. And, you know, whether Frank resigns or not or should or shouldn't isn't really my call. I think a lot of leaders in our state have spoken on that issue, and we've all heard what they had to say. Frank has heard it as well, and he made his decision. But come next September, the voters will make another decision, and I believe they'll do the right thing.
Are you concerned that his candidacy damages the Republican car as a whole?
I don't know that it does. I'll be running a campaign that's based on a positive message and how we're going to solve problems and how I'll represent the people of New Hampshire. And that's the sort of message we want folks to hear from the party. And I think as more people enter this race, and we know there'll be more, I think it'll be just fine.
Yeah, so let's talk about the 2014 race first. In the campaign that you ran, most people felt like, hey, that was a pretty good campaign. Nobody knew who you were coming out of there. A little late name ID, and you did, as you point out, come up just short. But if you could do something differently, or if there's something you've really learned that says, I'm not going to make that mistake again, what is it?
I think it would be how I spend the money. You know, it will be spent much more wisely this time. Last campaign, I spent too much too quickly. You know, you do that in part to build the name ID, so it wasn't a bad decision, but this time the name ID is higher. I know more going in. I know who to reach out to and how to reach out to them. And you'll see that I'll be adding staff gradually over the next several months and won't be starting full on as I did last time.
How are you going to describe, what kind of Republican are you going to describe yourself as? I'm not saying you've changed since 2014, but clearly in this day and age, there are different kinds of Republicans.
Well, I suppose, and you know, the media enjoys sort of dividing the party into pieces, and I'm not sure I buy into
that. Say national media. I don't enjoy it.
You are national media. Never WMUR. You're right. You're actually right about that. But the national media does like to do that. We saw it a little bit last night, and they talk about the divisions in the House and so on. And you know, I don't really buy into that. I am a strong fiscal conservative, and that's clear. And that's how I'll run. I believe in small government. I believe in getting government out of our lives, simplifying the tax code, reducing the corporate tax rate, taking a look at regulation, trying to make it easier for businesses to do business so they can grow and hire, grow the economy, and help the middle class. I mean, that's really what I'm about. And that, to me, is the core of the Republican message.
Sure, but in order for you to be successful, you kind of need to get a number of people underneath that umbrella. So how does Dan Innes, who will bring in the fiscal conservatives, get some of the social conservatives over there to say, you know what, this is our guy too?
You know, I think in New Hampshire, we do have that live free or die attitude. And, you know, let's keep government out of our lives and keep it small and protect our personal liberty. That is a key for me, and I think it's a key for the people in New Hampshire. But when it comes to how I live my life, I mean, we want to be left alone, and we want to be able to do that. And that is the approach that I take. The social issues really don't come up that much in the campaign trail. We've decided many of these issues, and you know, when they come up, I'm certainly happy to talk about them, but I really believe it's solving the nation's fiscal problems, our international affairs problems, and that sort of thing that's driving the conversation.
So let me ask you, let's hypothesize, let's say that you're down there right now and we're having this debt ceiling debate. I mean, where are you?
You know, I am not a fan of how it was resolved.
Why?
It was done too quickly. There wasn't enough planning. And that's the big problem you see in D.C. We're not planning. We're not thinking ahead. We don't have a strategy to solve our problems. And you need that. If you're running a company or you're running a university, you have a strategic plan. And you know what you're going to be doing over the next 3 to 5 years, where you'll invest your money, where you'll get your money, and how you'll grow this thing. Washington needs the same approach. We shouldn't be solving the budget problem in a week and rushing a vote through. We've got to do this thoughtfully. And I do hope that Paul Ryan will do that.
Even if it comes with the idea of a little nervousness and a little sweat on the brow that, you know what, we're getting close to shutting down the government here, and we're playing with the markets, which, as we know, are pretty fragile as it is.
They're very fragile right now. You know, you should never, I don't think government should ever shut down. And I think it's a failure of leadership when government shuts down. It's
but
an absolute failure. It's used as a club, but,
sure. But
you know, look, when you pass a budget, you know you're going to run up against the debt ceiling, right? So when you pass the budget, pass the debt ceiling increase with it. The key is to pass a responsible budget that's thoughtfully done and that's fiscally responsible, and that's what we're not doing. That's the bigger problem. The debt ceiling is sort of something we create as a problem. The real problem is the budget itself. So let's get after that.
All right, let's talk about foreign policy because the next Congress is going to have to deal
with it. Do we have one, or have we let that go?
I get what you're trying to say.
I'm not sure we have one at the moment.
Let's talk about the situation unfolding in Europe. I'll phrase it like that.
That's a disaster.
Refugees that are crossing into borders. The president has said he'd like to accept tens of thousands here. How do you feel about that?
You know, we are a nation that wants to help, and we've always been a nation that helps. And we've often been a refuge for people who are persecuted or otherwise face problems in their country. And I think the American character is one that wants to help. On the other hand, I think we have to be real smart about how we do this. We can't accommodate too many of these folks. We have our own issues right now that we have to deal with. It will put a strain on our economy. We're seeing that in Europe. I mean, some countries in Europe have to shut this off, even though they'd rather not, because they can't handle it. So we've got to be real careful. We also have to be careful about who we let in. Who are these people that are coming? And are they folks that will be okay here?
Yeah, for a lot of folks, that's the number one component here, is making sure that we're actually bringing in true refugees and there's a security component.
That's right. And I'm not yet convinced that they're all true refugees. I'm just not.
Well, and careful monitoring certainly is something that most people agree would need to be done. We'll see what happens there.
Absolutely.
But in Europe itself, what do you see as the U.S. role? Some are calling for safe havens in and around Syria, led by a U.S.-enforced no-fly zone.
You know, I think in the ideal case, we set up situations over there where, you know, the Middle East nations are helping the Middle East nations. And when you look at it, we're not seeing a lot of assistance coming from the Middle East itself. And there are countries over there with enormous resources that can help with this, and they're not stepping up. And I think we have to try to force that to happen a little bit. We've got to lead, and America has to lead the world, whether we like that or not. I personally think it's a good thing. But we are the leader of the free world, and we need to continue to play that role. Not necessarily be the policeman, but we certainly have to lead, and we've got to do that there. You know, in terms of Europe, we can work with them and try to help them along, but they've got to make some of these decisions on their own. But ultimately, it's a Middle East problem. Let's get the Middle East nations to help one another.
Yeah, coalition building is very difficult in that area, but there is a consensus there. We only have a couple of minutes to go, a little bit less, but moving forward to win this thing, Republicans have their talking points, and most people can say, all right, there's an R next to their name. I know how they feel about this, and this. Mm-hmm. Is there any particular area where you appoint to be like, you know what, I have some different ideas, I have some different views, and this is what might separate me from a primary field that does include a Frank Gantt, maybe a Pam Tucker or a Rich Ashew?
Yeah, I think the thing that really separates me is my background and experience. I've got a very different approach to this than any other candidate. I've been an educator. I've been a business person. I understand how to move complex organizations. I mean, you talk about politics. Try moving a university forward. It's pretty tough there. And I think it's that background that makes me different. It's someone who comes at this understanding what small businesses are facing every day. I haven't worked at a major company, right? I've worked for small companies, and I've worked to help people to grow and to build careers. And I understand the struggles that young people are facing in a way that I don't think anyone else in this race or talking about this race, you know, I don't think they have that perspective. And to me, that's valuable. And I think I bring a richness of experience, a breadth of experience, that gives me a different perspective on things.
Quickly, is there going to be a slow climb into this thing? Because obviously a lot of the oxygen right now is being taken up by the president.
You know it is. And yeah, the climb will be relatively slow. We'll get to February and then we'll go full on. But I think as we get toward the end of this year and into the new year, we'll pick it up pretty dramatically.
Right, well, best of luck moving forward. Congratulations
well,
on your decision.
Great
Come
to be back.
Anytime. We'll talk again, I'm sure.
I'm sure.